Once upon a time, or roughly 10,999 tweets ago, I vowed to make a film about Twitter. Because it seems to be an impossible film to make. I was so determined, I even set up a website to crowdsource Twitter stories. An artist in New York heard of my plan, through social media of course, and decided to help me. This film is the result.
Government got it on Twitter. I don't want to be involved with it.
The government's on everything, isn't it?
Well, not Twitter especially. When I saw them on C-SPAN, it alarmed me right away.
But is it okay if we use this in the documentary?
Oh, I don't care.
Okay. But there are millions of people who do trust Twitter. What do you say to them?
10% of the human family deceived 85% of the human family. 5% of us, no.
Take care. Thanks for letting
us
use
it. Stay off Twitter, man. Be careful what you say on Twitter, baby.
Okay.
Trust me when I say that.
Hi, my name is Darren. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about Twitter today.
Are you a used car salesman or are you just pretending to be one?
So we're being recorded? Is my soul being extracted? There's several remarkable happenings. Hey, take a look at this waist. I'm down 50 pounds this year. 5-0. Yeah, I'm still got a little bit to lose. I know I'm not perfect. What I used Twitter for during this time was to basically log every meal I ate. It's almost become this interactive thing where people want to go on Twitter and share me their meals, and I really like that. Because I heard Twitter was a stupid place that people just talked about what they wanted to have for lunch, and I said, well, that's where I belong. Because I like lunch too. Have fun, and use my video, and put me all over, make me viral. I've been framed. Hey, my new avatar picture. Come on, bring it.
I flew halfway across the world, from Singapore to New York, in search of Twitter. Not so much Twitter, the technology, but what it is in the hearts and minds of those who use it. Twitter's not unlike a mythic creature. There have been many claims of Twitter sightings, but it seems everyone is describing something different.
Hey, we're doing a documentary on Twitter.
How are you?
Holding their
cell phones as they walk around.
Right, right, right.
You should have got me when he almost got hit by the bus.
There you see, there you are.
Twitter lets you look over people's shoulders. It's a very intimate place to be. It's people allowing you into their lives and telling you a whole series of things that they normally wouldn't put out there.
Twitter is like a cocktail party.
I really, truly believe it's like the wild, wild west.
Connections. It's the world connected to me.
Controlled serendipity.
Twitter is Twitter. I mean, I could say Twitter is amazing, but that would be redundant. I'm telling you, I have a Twitter crush on Twitter. I know, it's creepy, but...
How does someone like Adventure Girl become famous on Twitter? On Twitter, you can post quick updates known as tweets. Each tweet has to be 140 characters or less. Your tweets can be seen by people who subscribe to them. In other words, your followers. It's very easy to find and follow people on Twitter. Everyone has a Twitter handle, a unique name that identifies them. You can follow someone with just one click. But it's just as easy to unfollow or even block someone.
Everybody can be a celebrity, and that's the beauty of it. It gives everybody a voice.
Stephanie has almost 1.5 million followers on Twitter. Twitter has brought her media attention and celebrity status. But skeptics have questioned the value of a large Twitter following.
Popularity with each passing day means less and less on Twitter.
Today, the same types of people who know how to spam, how to game the search engines have also hopped onto Twitter.
What's the value? You know, what one person has 80,000 followers. Are they really reaching out to those 80,000? Do they know those 80,000?
You're no one if you're not on Twitter. I'm there already, you've missed it. If you haven't been bookmarked, retweeted, and blogged, you might as well not have existed. You might as well not have existed.
How does someone become world famous for 15 minutes? Yannis Krooms is the perfect person to ask. His claim to fame? He was the first person to tweet a photo of the US Airways flight crash landing in the Hudson River.
My 15 minutes, as they say, of fame, where I'm known for that one event. I feel like I'm the same person, it's just I have now a very cool story I can tell people.
On January 15, 2009, Yannis changed the way the world looked at Twitter.
Initially, it was fear. I didn't know what happened before it crashed into the water. And I happened to be on Twitter at the time, and I took it, posted it to my 170 followers.
Little did he know that his photo would be retweeted 100,000 times, causing the photo sharing website to crash.
He used TwitPix, which was 32 days old at the time. And then he went and helped a flight attendant with two broken legs. Came back, somebody handed him back his phone, and he found himself talking to MSNBC, who was showing the photo he had taken 27 minutes earlier. And the world's press just picked up what he had to say.
The fact that you have now on Twitter so many people who are field reporters because they're just there, people who have cell phones, digital cameras, who have a Twitter account, and suddenly they can post a picture, a video, a text account of what is happening right in front of them.
They will never be the first on the scene from now on. There will always be someone with a camera phone, some video, and they're going to be someone always there first.
After years of mainstream media disdaining Twitter, they're now understanding that the very feet on the street that they used to have and can no longer afford to have are here in Twitterville.
Twitter is not going to kill journalism. It's a part of the journalistic act of gathering information and telling the story.
I'm from Latvia. I happen to be in New York. I've been on the ferry many times, but to be in the right place at the right time like that, I mean, and to know how to use also Twitter and all the different services, it's such a wild thing.
My encounter with Yannis left me with more questions than answers. If Twitter helps spread information, will it not also spread misinformation?
Twitter is an incredibly powerful tool that's revolutionizing the world, but in my heart of hearts, after my experience, it scares me to death.
Dr. Amy Beam now tweets using a pseudonym. She's an IT specialist who spends part of her time in Turkey. Her interest in the Middle East led her to Twitter during the Iran elections.
Tweets were pouring in at over 300 new tweets per minute.
Then Amy saw a tweet linking to this YouTube video. This image of Neda shot to death became the iconic image of the revolution. Amy tried to find out who the real Neda is by searching on Facebook. One woman, an English professor in Tehran, responded to her.
Neda Sultani wrote back to me saying, no, it wasn't me. Thank you for your concern and pray for my people. At that point, the living Neda Sultani and I became Facebook friends.
This is Neda, the woman who died. This is also Neda, but she's a living woman. The unthinkable happened. Someone copied the Facebook picture of the living Neda onto the web.
And people kept tweeting websites, 1 to 5 to 10 to 100 to 10,000.
And major media outlets all started carrying it.
Every time I would notify a website that they had the wrong photo, 6 more websites had the photo. By morning, I had to email her and say, Neda, it's too late. I can't put this in my house.
Soon, the living Neda was hounded by the Iranian government and accused of conspiracy. Neda fled Iran. She now lives in exile in Germany.
The power of misinformation and the speed of transmitting it to make something that's false into a so-called true story is terribly frightening to me.
We talk about 140 characters, but the most important character is 141st, and that's the one in which the tweeter and the tweetee meet in real time. They meet face to face, and they truly build on what can be a lasting relationship.
To help me find the heart of Twitter, I enlisted the help of my friend David Blumenstein. He's a self-proclaimed offline anarchist who also happens to be a member of the New York Twitterati.
Now we're heading to the unofficial capital of social media in New York City, the Roger Smith Hotel, where everybody's on Twitter.
Imagine a place where everyone knows everyone else from Twitter, and you get the Roger Smith Hotel.
It's just amazing how people can become friends from a tweet. It is no handshakes. These are hugs. These are family. Immediately, our brothers and sisters.
Okay.
Just go right in. This is Martha and Candace.
Okay, well, Martha,
because that's what we do on Twitter. It's a brain cancer meetup, the big Twitter party. Oh, yeah, please, yeah, come follow us.
Yamilu brings follow me behind support. The scenes of a tweet-up. Or a Twitter meetup.
I know how to drive, huh?
I wonder if people speak in 140 characters, even when they meet face to face.
Okay, hey.
I'll show you the sign. I'll show you the board. Follow us on Twitter at Brain Cancer Meetup. It's really sad, but it's really good also that people are joining together. I can't explain it. It's so overwhelming that people love to tweet.
In New York City, there seems to be some meetup in the name of Twitter every night. Early adopters get together to explore and celebrate this brave new world, where neighborhoods are defined by shared interests and not just physical location.
Twitter, I found the people who understand me. I'm more connected now than ever. I never lose touch with the people who matter the most. And we don't waste characters exchanging vapid quips about the weather. And as for the friends I had before, I don't talk to them anymore.
It turns out the Twitter meetups are just the tip of the iceberg. The entire conference is devoted to Twitter, like the 140 characters conference curated by Jeff Pulver, who's himself quite a character.
Jeff Pulver, casting director, 140 Character Conference.
Jeff Pulver from jeffpulver.com, and no, I am not a used car salesman.
It's Jeff Pulver, and you're invited to join me in a cast of 140 amazing people who pull on characters. Come to New York City June 16th and 17th.
They're absolutely about nothing until a character is discovered, and then another character is discovered. And then eventually we get to experience the theater of the people.
the advent of Twitter, really the advent of the real-time web, I think, is changing paradigms in terms of how we work. How
Jeff
we live,
invited me to 140 conference meetup in New York.
Serendipity on Twitter or meeting total strangers, and you haven't really realized that your voice matters. I'll tell you it does.
There was almost a religious fervor in the room.
I think the revolution's happening, whether or not we recognize it or not. People, more than anything else, have a chance to be sociologists or real-time social webologists at the conferences.
The power of Twitter is that it is now the global default chat space. Almost any conference you have, Twitter is the back channel for what's going on.
By adding the 140 conference hashtag to their tweets, the attendees make it possible for anyone across the world to follow the event in real time. Simply by tracking the hashtag. A hashtag is a way of labeling a topic on Twitter, and anyone can take the lead to create one. They could be dead serious or just plain silly. Those that become popular will show up on Twitter search as a trending topic. When a disaster strikes or major news breaks, people quickly settle on a hashtag, making it easy for everyone to share and track the latest updates.
In some sense, you get a feeling for what's happening in the world. And there's a lot of people right now talking about the real-time web or the flow of information. But if you dip into the Twitter stream and you see what's up, you get this notion of a zeitgeist of what's really up.
How many of you guys are on Twitter? How many of you guys have over 1,000 followers? After Iran over the summer, after the miracle on the Hudson, Twitter has sort of hit mainstream.
Will that be a Twitter Pulitzer Prize, you think?
There's a cartoon where the guy at Columbia standing up here with 2012 Pulitzer's the best tweet.
This conference that I have next.
Although I couldn't fully comprehend it, I found the passion for Twitter in the room to be strangely moving.
We ended up with about 140 people.
Remain perversely curious about the dark side of Twitter.
Twitter, I laughed and I thought, man, that's kind of funny.
The next day, we left on a road trip heading towards the 140 conference in Los Angeles.
Caught the bus in New York City, heading
my quest for Twitter continues. As we rode overnight from New York into Chicago, we sent out tweets asking people to give us story news.
Picked up the telephone, Twitter. Twittered on, looked and see if I had a DM there.
By evening, we found ourselves on the bank of Chicago River. People on Twitter responded to our request and pointed us to the social media event of the night.
What do you get out of Twitter?
What do I get out of Twitter? I get business out of Twitter.
And then watch this.
The wonder and the beauty of it all is that we're now finally able to find each other. And now on the internet, suddenly we're able to collect together a whole lot more quickly. It used to be we had to fit ourselves into the world. Now the best we can do is be ourselves. Pull the world that fits us to us.
And it seems not only does Twitter help us find like-minded people, it also makes it easier for us to find someone to complain to.
A pizza, a Domino's pizza on Twitter. It came late,
and they delivered the wrong pizza. So I sent a quick tweet out. I was very hungry, very frustrated.
What happened was April 21st, about 9 o'clock at night, she vented the fact that we got one of her pizzas wrong. She had ordered three.
Less than an hour later, I got a response back from Ramon De Leon on Twitter, who is the owner of six Chicago Domino's franchises, saying that he was going to make it up to me.
For me, this is a little bit of a social media fire that I need to put out with some social media water.
I wanted to send a video message as an apology to Amy Corin. I hope I didn't get that last name wrong, but known as Interactive Amy. First of all, thank you very much for allowing us the opportunity to serve you last night. But unfortunately, as I explained to you, Junior, you know, we dropped the ball on one of her pizzas.
Yeah.
You know, I have reached out to you. I apologize that it took me an hour to see your first tweet, and we did exchange information in the morning today. But Amy, let me tell you, I got your back.
He wowed me with his customer service, and it's been so popular that it's actually been embedded on over 80,000 blogs.
So what I didn't expect actually happened. That video got retweeted, and people started sharing it all over the world.
And what compounded that was not only the delay in the first pizza, but I think we got one of the pizzas wrong. We are going to remake the entire order, and we are going to wow you.
And people are using that as an example on how to be open, how to be accessible, how to be transparent, and how to respond to the customer's needs.
He's spoken at Harvard at the Gravity Summit, and it was covered on CNN. And all of this, you know, he gave the example of the video apology.
Anytime you need a hookup, say, hey, Junior, saw you on Twitter. Hook me up. Or everybody, DPZ Ramon, you know it, the pizza guy to know in Chicago for awesome deals. Junior, DPZ Ramon, we are out of here.
Runs the theater, Matt Barbera. I've kind of influenced him in using Twitter, and he came to me one day and he's like, what about doing a show about Twitter on an improv and using people's tweets? And we call it The Tweet Life. And I was just like, oh my God, that's gold.
Chicago is the capital of improv comedy in America. So it's no surprise that the idea of using Twitter for improv has caught on.
Terry, use your security badge.
The person that we follow is in the audience, and so you have this relationship with them. We take like 15 of their tweets, and then as you're doing a scene...
Linford Winery. Well, my birthday is Sunday, so I'm thinking a visit to see you soon.
You pull out a strip of paper, and you read that tweet.
Oh, happy birthday!
And then that suggests that one scene.
Came from a winery!
A double chocolate milkshake!
I'm gonna get...
Improv is happening real time, right? And that's what Twitter is.
You want a chunky milkshake?
Y'all know how Twitter can expand. And you can have, like, it bloom into some huge conversation. When you're improvising, it's the same thing. You're building off of things. We call it yes and.
That love seat ain't got no love in it.
It's been a huge success.
Yeah! Yeah!
After meeting the super Twitter users at the Chicago Social Media Club, it's time for a reality check at the local diner.
It is what it is. It ain't what it ain't.
That's the John Hancock building.
So you know about Twitter?
We know about Twitter, yeah.
All right, and what do you know about it? What is Twitter?
It is a network, a community where people can go all around the world and they can share the different experiences that they have going in life so people know right now what's going on, what I'm doing.
Excellent, excellent. Do you guys know what Twitter is?
No.
Do you?
They know how to Twitter. They were Twittering this morning in the car.
Really?
They were sounding like a bunch of birds back there. They were whistling.
Oh, right. Excellent, excellent. Thank you,
I gotta run. We follow a story lead from Twitter we met the night before. I was told there would be one story that would convince me for good. That Twitter isn't just a place where people talk about what they're having for lunch. It's a place where major financial news breaks.
Interesting thing about Twitter is that I never even knew anything about it until the whole Ashton Kutcher, CNN, big media buzz that occurred. And once that happened, I think it drew a lot of people, traders down here on the floor, other industries, into the whole Twitter world.
Traders like Richard can now build his personal reputation by sharing his thoughts in real time on Twitter.
See, what I'm watching right now is I'm watching the action that's occurring in the pit. Like what we've been seeing today is that the British pound futures are down 315 pips and continuing lower. So what I've just done is taken all the information that I have from the pits, from my news services, from my screens here, and I'll make that a concise message. I mean, the whole point of Twitter is not for background information or reading history of something that occurred yesterday. It's what occurred in the last 30 seconds. You can be guaranteed that when a major event happens, it could be dealing with trading or just a global economic event. Almost always, I find it on Twitter before I find it on any other news source.
What used to be gossip and banter on the trading floor may now determine or even rock market sentiment.
Privacy and information, you know, online too. I think that is going to be an issue that just keeps growing. Yeah. You know, especially as more companies are online. I mean, inside information, there is always that possibility. I mean, there are going to be mistakes. People are going to make mistakes.
Yeah, somebody's at a shareholder meeting and they tweet information about it before it comes out in the public.
The adrenaline of the trading floor may soon become something of the past.
If your hands are facing in, it means I want to buy. If your hands are facing out, it means I want to sell. And then you have to find somebody in the pit to trade with. And when you find somebody in the pit to trade with, you execute the trades on your hands. So you may say, I'll sell you 10, or you may say, I'll buy 100. Future of trading is definitely going to be all electronic. There won't be any of this floor activity. Hopefully I'll be one of the last ones to leave the floor when it goes, but unfortunately the floor is on its way out, and that's one of the things that the internet, Twitter, electronic trading, all these things change the way businesses occur.
From the world's largest exchange to the problem of homelessness, these are photos taken by Mark Horvath, an advocate for the homeless, who has a large following on Twitter. She's still there, alone in the dark. Mark called us while we were riding into Chicago, saying we got to meet Anne Marie, a homeless Twitterer. Strange as it seems.
Somewhere in her broken
dream, she was
sweet.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
We
really wanted us to meet you.
And we were... You're right. Are yes. You hungry by any chance? Can we invite you to lunch?
Sure.
Anne-Marie told me she was living out of a car until it got towed. And now she had to go to a different shelter every night.
There's a lot to live with.
She had been homeless for 4 years and suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder. But she could not afford the medication.
Too many choices. The homeless have all kinds of mental illness. It's very hard to get any of it taken care of and treated because most places want money. I go to the library to use Twitter. I share a lot of information on Twitter about my life and things that I need. A piece of mail here I got because of Twitter. I've got one more the post office has lost. Pillowcase and the fitted sheet. You just are so grateful to be able to get these things. Kind of like Christmas in a way. You know, you're getting something, and it's like a new toy. I mean, I can't wait to go to shelter tonight and try these out. I really can't.
So now having found your voice, do you think that Twitter may help you get out of homelessness? Is it something that you've ever thought of?
It's changed my whole mood and my outlook about everything. It's given me a little more motivation, and it's connecting me with people. Twitter is networking.
Right before we left Chicago, I was able to say thank you to Diane. We had been connected on Twitter for half a year. But this was the first time we met.
I don't think they believe you're over 21.
She had been the invisible hand behind our Chicago shoot, helping us connect with key people.
That's the oldest trick in the book. It's not for me, it's for my mom. And why do you want a Twitter account? What do you want
to
do?
So then I can, like, talk to people that I don't know.
Anyway, what is Twitter?
It's like a .com, like an email thing, but like you get to pick icons and stuff like that, avatars.
Sure, you know, you end up explaining Twitter to people all the time who don't know what it is and who think it's everybody talking about what they ate for breakfast and all that. And so for me, I just tell people it's what you make of it. So it started out as a really good news aggregator and for my business. And then you start engaging with people as opposed to just reading what they say. You start talking back. And the next thing you know, you've developed friendships.
It is what it is. It ain't what it is.
We invited Anne-Marie to join us on a road trip to Los Angeles.
It is what it is.
She will be speaking about homelessness with Mark Hoveth at the 140
conference. And share my story with everyone. There's a lot of false beliefs out there for what being homeless really is like. I want people to see, the real world of homelessness.
Hello there, Twitterverse. Where are you gonna go? Please don't curse.
Getting to know Anne-Marie made me think about how our real-time connections shape our sense of identity. Is being homeless, period, any different from being homeless but with 500 followers on Twitter? What does life look like from the front view of a truck? Woman trucker Desiree Woods is one person I would like to meet. But her location is almost impossible to pin down.
People on Twitter get this impression that I'm some sort of a rock star, but in reality, I'm always by myself with the dog. If I'm lonely, I get on Twitter at 24 hours a day. I have a friend on there from somewhere around the world.
Desiree has turned Twitter into a soapbox, speaking out against sexual assault within the trucking industry. She landed major interviews and even testified in support of a change in legislation in Texas.
I got raped in Dallas 20 years ago. It did change me. Waking up with somebody face to face with you with a knife in your own bed, in your own house, makes you crystal clear in your mind that you are never safe anywhere in any way, shape, or form.
But her high visibility on Twitter is a double-edged sword. She has to face down death threats sent via Twitter.
When people attack me, it never makes me want to go away. It makes me want to do it more. My objective was to take the story outside of the trucking industry because the trucking industry wasn't really interested in fixing what was going on in the trucking industry. So
I'm in a parking lot, actually, and the dog is sitting in the front seat, which she's on Twitter also. That's truck and dog karma.
And so the dog is kind of like a Twitter sweetheart. It was people on Twitter that were there when I rescued the dog. Usually on our walk, get her pictures out with her point of view.
Desiree's dog is an even bigger star on Twitter than she is. Behind these doggy and kitty tweets lies a genuine concern for animal welfare.
It's really fun to log into her account. There's a whole different community on Twitter of dog rescue organizations and animal rescue organizations.
There's something just a little depressing about a dog having more followers than me, a human being. It just goes to show, every dog has to stay on Twitter, or may even become a trending topic.
He's trending. Oh my God, he's dead. Or maybe someone found a sex tape. Or maybe he just paid for it. Or maybe, maybe, just maybe, he's appeared on YouTube, accidentally sitting on a kitten.
I'm walking backwards into the future. I'm walking backwards into the future. You can't see me there in front of you. You're living in the past. I'm walking back.
It's very difficult just living this way, not knowing how things are going to end up. When will I have a home again? You want it to happen now, and it's, you know, after so long, you start to wonder, will it ever?
Talking to myself and you, I hear the wind.
The sunset was gorgeous, but it looked like we would be stranded in Colorado at midnight because we would be missing our onward connection. Although at Greyhound is on Twitter, they sure ain't listening to our complaints. But as it turned out, someone else was listening. Paul Swanson followed our misadventures on Twitter. Although he has never met us in real life, he came to meet us at the bus station at midnight and offered us a place to stay for the night.
You let folks know that you were having a challenge, and I responded to you and said, you know, hey, if you're going to be in Denver, if you got a layover or anything, let me know, give me a call, whatever you need, you know, we'll help you out.
Let's do a photo op. Let's do a photo op.
Here, and we're going to do a new tweet. We've used Twitter to go ahead and establish that trust connection. Doing something like this is the most natural thing to do. It's that connectedness, that need of connectedness that everybody has.
Thank you, Paul.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome.
It was a minor miracle, but we caught a connecting bus in the nick of time.
What you mean? Ooh, doesn't seem what it seems. Are we lost in a dream?
Las Vegas was the last stop before we landed in Los Angeles. I've heard a lot about the red light district on Twitter. So we went around hoping to get someone to talk to us. And of course, no one would. But as we left Las Vegas, I sent out a tweet sharing my disappointment at our setback. As luck would have it, someone tweeted back, pointing me to a certain Mika Tan who may be willing to talk.
Can I show my shirt? Because it's funny.
And I am not a terrorist. I am broadcasting here from Carson City, Nevada, where I work at the Moonlight Bunny Ranch as a legal prostitute. And I love Twitter.
Mika is the chief dominatrix at the Moonlight Bunny Ranch. She first took to Twitter to stay in touch with her friends in the business, but she found Twitter to be surprisingly useful, especially when she got lost on the way to a strip club.
I can't find this strip club, and I immediately got 5-6 different people sending me directions. Okay, do you see that big boat RV center? Yes, turn left there. It's like text messaging your friends, but you have 12,000 of them.
A prostitute in hot demand and a famous porn star. But Mika also reveals her normal side on Twitter, what she calls her Clark Kent mode.
Gives us a common ground to have a conversation. Sometimes it's a little awkward when people just walk in and you're like, yeah, we're having sex, by the way. I don't know anything about you, but let's go.
From her tweets, I catch glimpses of her wistfulness and not being able to have a regular life.
I tried to get a regular job and I tried to date regular guys, and it's almost impossible. If you've been in the business for over a year, you're pretty much saturated in the market. Your face is on box covers. Concern with Twitter and the marketing and promotion of porn is there's really no age control. Block! Block! As soon as I find out, or I look at their picture and I was like, they're really too young. I have to block them. It's hard because there's no place to put your age. So you just have to go by your gut. And I just don't want it. I don't even want to entertain minors.
Mika also knows that Twitter can be a minefield when it comes to attracting stalkers.
With me or anybody I'm with, I tell them, never tell people where we are when we're there. I got alarmed because I was at the airport and I took a picture of these little corn nuggets. And I said, yes, I'm at the Atlanta airport. And then I had 3 military guys came over because they read me on their Twitter. And they said, oh, we heard you were here at this restaurant. Can we take a picture? And then I was thinking, oh, I'm not naive to believe that there aren't dangerous people out there. They're not strange people out there that wouldn't mind slicing and dicing me and wearing my skin, you know?
It is odd to hear Mika talk about the same things that social media gurus preach. Listening and engagement, conversation and customer service. She even offers discounts to her Twitter followers to hilarious effect.
I started offering discounts, like military discounts, law enforcement. I had a guy that added them all up. He goes, okay, now what if I was an Army veteran who's a volunteer firefighter working at the police department? He added it all up to where I had to pay him to have sex. And I said, you bastard.
Twitter me this, Twitter me that. Here we go down the past. Vegas straight ahead. Then I saw through sleepy eyes the gray LA sky.
Some people Twitter like if they're having breakfast that day. You know, that's not really. Like my brother keeps Twittering me, he's having breakfast. Big deal. You know, but I like it more like for advertising, like getting the word out about your business. And
we just kind of started this business, like meeting the general public. So we are starting to Twitter, and I Twitter a lot.
Yeah, Twitter me this and Twitter me that. DM message back to Pat. Tell her we made it all the way. New York to L.A. Singapore to LA.
Our Twitter odyssey was about to draw to a close, and we finally met Mark, a homeless advocate. It was Mark who first gave us the lead to Anne-Marie in Chicago.
No, I've never had the experience of people following me around with cameras all day for several days. I love probably almost any experience that I can learn from. It was my 2 days in the Starlight.
This you could wear over jeans to dress it up a little bit, yeah. The heels.
Maybe for one of the parties.
Yep.
Me and Mark know.
Anne-Marie will be speaking on stage at 140 conference the next day. Mark called upon his friends on Twitter, Marsha and Heather, to help Anne-Marie get ready for her moment in the spotlight.
I'd seen her on Twitter. I had friended her on Twitter. I knew that it was going to be difficult enough for her to stand in front of an audience. But a woman likes to look nice. Homeless or not, she needed that extra boost.
It's like phoning someone without having to speak. It's like dating someone without having to flirt. It's like going to a party without having to stand in a room with loads of people who might not like you. It's a conversation without having to wait for someone who wants to listen.
Ago, I had a good paying job in the television industry, and 15 years ago, I ended up homeless right here on Hollywood Boulevard. I was sitting here, I had a 6-foot iguana. I was depressed. I was just like this, how am I going to survive? So there was a tourist bus that pulled over to the corner. They all surrounded me and said, can I take a picture of your iguana? And I was all like this, and I said, sure, for a dollar. And they all handed me a dollar. And all of a sudden, I became the lizard man of Hollywood Boulevard. Okay.
Oh, you're looking at me, Twittering.
Can Twitter get anybody out of homelessness? Can Twitter wipe my ass? Can Twitter feed a cow? Can Twitter do anything? No. But people can.
Mark didn't manage to convince me that Twitter could solve a complex problem like homelessness. But we both look forward to Anne-Marie's talk at the conference.
When I first met her in Chicago, she was sleeping in a grassy lot in Chicago. And she used Twitter to vent, to escape. But also she felt, because she had 500 followers at the time, that she was less lonely. Can you imagine that? We're her family. We're all she has.
Here we were at last, at the Kodak Theater, where they hold the Oscars every year.
Now, and where are we now?
We're in LA.
And what are we doing here?
We're here for the 140 Characters Conference.
Coming off our road trip, I knew if I heard one more great Twitter story, I would scream. But I got to say, this is a good one.
I have a great story about Twitter, the power of Twitter, Twitter love. I went to the 140 Character Conference in New York, and my laptop got stolen. And I posted one tweet saying how upset I was with it and distraught. That one tweet started my followers to raise money for me to buy me a new laptop. So 97 people donated money, and I engraved all their names on my new laptop. And the amazing thing is that they did this in less than a day. Twitter in itself is a very trusting medium. You give and you receive. I mean, I give people a peek in my life and they like that. And so they give me something back. I always compare it sort of to a hippie commune where everybody is willing to help everybody out.
To an amazing feature on the iPhone. It's called the phone. With the phone, you can dial a number and someone answers on the other end in real time. Has everyone made at least one phone call or made one text that had nothing to do with, like, can you post this one? Can you do this for me? Bottom line is, make a phone call, send a text message, tell somebody you're thinking about them, give them a hug. That's good.
Yeah.
I'm not Don Draper, by the way, but this is Don Draper. The title of the book is From Bad Man to Twitter Hall. And I'm not Don Draper, but I am an ad guy, and I have become a Twitter Hall.
Twitter is built for characters. It is in such a natural extension of your web series, TV series, movie, to have your characters on Twitter.
Misinformation and shallowness have been around as long as human nature has been around. They were not brought here by the media. In fact, I would say that we are now entering a kind of golden age for news consumers.
Media magnates, celebrities, and social media gurus. But it was clear who the real star of the conference was going to be.
In Chicago. I have two kids who I haven't seen in quite a while. I use Twitter as a tool, and it has helped tremendously as far as helping me improve myself. I use it to vent my frustrations, what happens to me. People actually come to me and are asking me for help because they are about to become homeless. Or they...
Seeing Anne Marie speak was moving, discomforting. It made me aware how lucky I am and that there is this tool that people can use and we can all communicate on the same level.
It has all come through.
This, to me, Anne Marie at PAX Chicago, is the most amazing Twitter story that I've ever heard of.
I feel great being here. A normal, successful person.
Doing all right. I'm having a good time.
Continue 0.2 miles to Los Angeles International Airport. Arriving at Los Angeles International Airport, on right.
Late, you know, but... I will miss it here, it's warm. Go back and see everybody and try to get a normal life. It will still be there, through Twitter, of course. Just connecting in a different way, over tweets instead of live. life I want. I want to, of course, get out of homelessness and be able to have a normal, productive life. That's what I want.
I honestly believe that Anne gave us more than we will ever be able to give her. I saw one guy tweet that he had such an amazing talk with her. They might not have ever had that experience with a homeless person. Not just one life was changed, but many lives were changed.
That very same week, we were heading across America on our quest for Twitter. A young man in Kansas City, Missouri, was also getting ready to travel to Canada. He was going to meet his Twitter friend Sarah in real life for the first time. One night, he sent out a few tweets, went to bed, and never woke up again. He died in his sleep of an undiagnosed heart condition. He was 34.
He passed away before he was able to come to Canada. It was absolutely heartbreaking.
In the womb of sleep, dreaming of places and times that have no meaning.
As a result of condolences online, and you can check a hashtag, you know, for Mac's name and see who else is, you know, was grieving at that time, picked up, you know, dozens of Twitter friends.
Mac's book on aliens and the paranormal was published posthumously. A writer who had a day job at Starbucks, Mac was also an avid ufologist.
He wasn't, you know, very well accepted within his physical, you know, location. The internet, you know, such a perfect venue is that the ones that were interested could find him. And once you found his blog, and if you had a taste for his personality, then you're hooked.
His grieving Twitter friends set up a tribute blog to honor his memory. Mac's mom contributed his childhood drawings and writings.
Space and dinosaurs are what I think about. When I wait in the dentist's office, I think about monsters or space. Most every night I have a dream. Once I dreamed my toys came out of my closet and attacked me. There's a part of me that doesn't want the conversation with the people I've met online to end. I don't want my discoveries of Mac to end. It's hard to finish things off, and it's hard to say goodbye.
Without knowing it. It may also be true that we never know which tweet we send out may become our last tweet. My quest for Twitter did not end with the road trip. I remained fascinated by Twitter as the very means of our connection and of our alienation. It is through Twitter that I learned that Yanis, the accidental citizen journalist, is now working on several internet startups. Mika left the Moonlight Bunny Ranch and is now semi-retired in the porn industry. Her quest for true love continues.
Actually, I started dating somebody off of Twitter. Not really officially dating. He hasn't changed his status on Facebook, to put it that way. We'll see how this goes. Because I really dig him, he's nice.
1 year after speaking at the 140 conference, Anne-Marie found housing through a contact on Twitter. After spending 5 years on the streets, this is a huge step forward.
It is unbelievable. Where would I be right now if I wasn't here? I'd be walking to a shelter in the middle of a blizzard or something. I'm just very grateful to be able to have found the housing, and through Twitter even. Speaking at the conference and the Twittamentary, it's like I have a social media resume. People are looking up to me more.
She even looks back on a crazy road trip with fond nostalgia.
It's very unlike me even to just go along with two perfect strangers who I know nothing about and say, okay, yeah, I'll travel with you. But something made me go. Something made me want to go with the two of you.
Now,
what do you learn from this?
Yeah, what did you learn from all of this time here?
The most challenging thing about making this film is to give up the film I had originally thought I would make to make the film I can make. I really wanted to make a global film, but the film that I end up being able to make with the help of people on Twitter is much smaller, much more intimate.
What is Twitter to you now?
Twitter has become a way of listening to my destiny, to really listen to the people who are responding, the people who want to help the film.
And then there was a girl out in Kansas City looking for a ride to who knows what for. But these people are connecting together and they ain't worried about me. They're connecting in a different way and it's gonna change you and me. Who needs a mass-produced media? Who needs a person telling them that they needed to eat on? Everybody has a voice of their own. Andy Warhol knew it all along. 15 minutes and you're on your way. And making it happen every day. Serendipity walks in and consequences begin. Serendipity wins. Serendipity wins.